Hello and welcome to Jazz Tonight. I'm Michael Jacoby, executive producer of Jazz on the Plaz and host of Raising the Standards on KSCO Radio in Santa Cruz. This is it. We're wrapping it up. Our homage to the great Ella Fitzgerald ends today, although by the time you see this, it would have been a little while. But if you did not make the show, you would have missed a very special man, Pete Escovedo.
Mike, great to be here. Good to see you again.
I got to tell you, we were talking about this the other day.
Yeah.
When we first met, it was 40 years ago this month.
Oh, my goodness.
I was running KPEN, and you were at, it was the precursor to San Jose Jazz. I think it was called Tapestry and Talent.
Yeah.
Your brother Coke was there?
Yeah, my brother Coke was there.
God bless
him. That was fun. Yeah.
That was
that's a long time ago, man.
You were in your late 20s, and I was seven.
Yeah, right.
Good to see you, my friend.
Good to see you. Nice to be here.
And the Ever Ready Bunny, you're still going, aren't you?
Man, I'm still going. I don't know. I keep thinking about, well, I got to retire one of these days. You know, I'm 83
now.
Tell
that to Tony Bennett. It doesn't work that well.
He's still going.
Yeah.
So I figured if Tony's still going, well, then I can still go too. Yeah. So, yeah, but it's been a busy year for me with the new CD out. Just been working like crazy, which is great.
Yeah. The new CD, we'll talk more about later. It's called Back to the Bay.
Back to the Bay.
And you've also got a book out.
I got a book out.
They don't normally let me handle things on the show, but I'm going to hold this up. It's called My Life in the Key of E.
Mm-hmm.
And you wrote this with, you wrote it. And then your daughter-in-law?
My daughter-in-law, yeah. Corrected all my mistakes.
Yeah. What about the book? Tell me, is it something you've thought about for a few years?
I have been, but luckily for me is that I've always kept a journal on my travels, what I was doing this part of the year or whatever. And so it was good to go back and look at my journals to remember all the stuff that I did. And so most of the book is really about my upbringing, how I started, my family, you know, going to Oakland. And
now, you were raised in the East Bay.
Yes. And I was born in Pittsburgh, California, small little town. And my dad, because he came from Mexico, and we used to work as a family out on the fields. Yeah. You know, that's what we did, going from town to town. And I was born in Pittsburgh. Some of the other kids were born in some of the other small towns around the Bay Area. But he got a job at in Oakland at the Army base. And so we moved to Oakland when I was about 4 years old. So growing up in Oakland has really been, you know, where I started my music career and the whole thing. So
a lot of music in the house when you were growing up?
Always. My dad loved to sing. He would love to sing. And he used to hang out and go to the ballrooms in those days when they had ballrooms.
Yeah.
And hang out there and hope to get a chance to sit in and sing a song with the bands. And so he made friends with all the orchestras, all the guys in the bands, invite them over to our house, and it was party time. So, you know, they would party.
Did your mom play?
My mom played a little piano. She loved music also. So, you know, growing up in that environment, and just all of us took to music.
What kind of music were you folks into?
Well, my dad.
Now, your dad's from Mexico.
Yes. And so
where's your mom from?
My mom's from San Francisco.
Oh, okay.
Well, my dad loved the mariachi kind of thing, yeah. But me and my brothers, we just started listening to a lot of different music. I grew up listening to jazz. I mean, I love jazz, and that I wanted to be a saxophone player because I heard that all the sax players got all the women, and they were really cool guys. So I said, that's what I want to do. Yeah.
At least the choice was for a good reason. Did you take up the saxophone?
Yeah, I had three lessons.
Oh, good.
Yeah,
the fourth lesson
I gave up.
Yeah.
Because I met this friend of mine from New York City, and he played percussion. He had just moved into the neighborhood in Oakland where we lived. And he told me, man, you know, I got a collection of records and, you know, Tito Puente, Machito, and just all those great bands. So I started listening to that stuff, and I said, man, I want to start playing rhythm, you know. So I took up percussion.
Chico Hamilton.
Yeah, all the guys.
Now,
yeah.
Did you listen to Krupa and those guys?
I listened to all the drummers and, you know.
Rich, obviously.
Yeah, I was very fortunate because at a young age, I got to meet all of the great musicians, Tito Puente, became a very close friend for many years. And of course, Cal Jader, and I worked with Cal. And yeah, just all the guys back in the Bay Area. We had a great time.
You know, we talk about the fact that the old days in jazz clubs, but Palo Alto was a very hip place.
Yes.
Cal Jader used to play up there at Butterfields.
Yes, that's right.
My old friend Moe's used to play at the In Your Ear, the Poppycock. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
There were some great clubs up there in those days.
Oh, yeah. Well, those days, you know, they had, even in San Francisco, they had the Jazz Workshop, Matador, Basin Street, Black Hawk, you know, all those great places. And so me and my brothers, we would sneak in and hang out and listen to all that music. Yeah.
How, were we talking when you took up percussion in your teens? Or what?
Yeah, I was about, 16, 17. Yeah, and I started playing in school, high school. And I just loved it, thought this is the way I want to go.
Now, did percussion work out as well as the saxophone with the girls?
No.
No.
No. Unfortunately, no. But I did meet one, and I'm still with the same one.
Out.
Yeah,
so
that worked out great.
That going for you. Yeah. How many brothers and sisters?
Well, my dad's first marriage, which that's where I came from, I have four brothers and three sisters. And then his second marriage, I had three more brothers and two more sisters. So, and we're all very close.
Yeah,
we don't look at each other as one from the other. Yeah, we're brothers and sisters. And all of my brothers in my dad's second marriage, they all play also. My brother Alejandro, he lives in Austin, and he does really well. Plays a different kind of music, but.
Now there's a happening town.
Yeah.
Austin, well.
Yeah, great town,
yeah.
Great city.
Great music
yeah.
town. And of course your daughter, Sheila E.
So my kids grew up the same way I grew up. They all grew up listening to music decided to make that their career, and they've done very well, all of them.
I have, Pete, never been big on the phrase Latin jazz. I like jazz is jazz.
Yeah,
Separating like that.
Yeah.
I know the Grammys do that as well. Did you play, when you first started, when you worked with Jader, you did more of a straight-ahead jazz thing, right?
Well, it was...
More traditional, I guess.
You know, the funny story about playing with Cal was, he called me up to come and play. We were going to play at the Sheraton Hotel in San Francisco on Market Street. Yeah. So I go in there, and Cal says, yeah, cool, man, we're going to play. And so the first song we're going to do is Doxy, about right now, about right here. And I go, Cal, I don't play drums. Yeah. I said, I thought you hired me to play percussion. He goes, well, you know what? You're going to play drums tonight. I said, okay.
So you had the standard setup.
Yeah, and I got by just, I can keep a beat playing jazz, but I'm really not a jazz drummer. So I got away with that night. And then after that, he called me for some percussion dates and stuff that we did, recorded, me and my brothers. And so great
now,
guy.
Now, explain what the word means when you describe yourself as percussionist.
Well, there are Latin percussion instruments. And the one who brought the timbales up front was, of course, Tito Puente.
Right.
But there's all the Cuban and Puerto Rican drummers that play conga drums. And then there's bongos and just a lot of little different kind of instruments, toys that we play for recording and stuff like that.
Are they as different as other instruments are different to each other?
Yeah, they're each different. They each take a different style in how to play each different instrument. But if you learn all three of them, it's very helpful because you get more work knowing that you can play all of them.
Yeah. We're going to take a little break. And first of all, as we go into the break, I want to thank our sponsors, Pruneyard Cinemas and the Cedar Room. They've been kind to support this show throughout the year. And I'll tell you what, you got to support them because they're a marvelous, marvelous venue in the Pruneyard, whether you're over for a flick or I'm doing Sammy all of a sudden, flick. or a cocktail. Check them out. We'll tell you a little bit about it. Be right back with Pete Escovedo.
Hello, and welcome to Pruneyard Cinemas, Silicon Valley's most unique movie-going experience, and the South Bay's only service-to-your-seat luxury theater. Since this concept is probably new to many of you, let me take a moment to help you make the most of your visit. At the Pruneyard, the show starts long before the film begins. From our media wall in our lobby, keeping you up to date on happenings here at the theater, to our concessions area, which is, well, pretty special. Oh, you had dinner and cocktails in mind? Well, you came to the right place. Our chef-driven kitchen and cedar room offers seasonal bites which pair perfectly with our craft cocktails, draft beers, and local wines, and are all available at the bar and at your seat. It's really quite simple. If you'd like something from concession, something from the kitchen, or from the bar, just press the call button to your right, and one of our servers will be with you in no time. So that's it, just place your order. Thank you. They will be back with your check long before that critical scene in the movie. Our goal is to not disrupt you or your neighbor's experience. So just put up your feet and enjoy the show.
And welcome back to Jazz Tonight. Jacoby with you and our dear friend, Pete Escovedo, who I guess you were Jazz in the Plaza probably 10, 12 years ago.
Yeah, it's been a while.
It has been a while. Yeah. This is our 16th season, but we were talking off camera about clubs. Circle Star.
Circle Star was a great place to play.
Yeah.
Yeah, I played there with Anita Baker.
Oh, wow.
But I got to see so many great people come
through
there.
Well, a friend of mine ran the place, Debbie O'Brien. I don't know if you remember her.
Yes, of course.
She passed last year, sadly, with a dear friend. And they bring Sinatra in.
Yeah, in fact, we went to the show.
I said, how can you afford that? She said, we can't. It was like $450,000 for the weekend or something. Man. But he was special. Sammy, we were talking about.
Sammy, I love Sammy.
What a good guy.
He was such a character, man. But he was a great, great guy. He loved, you know, he loved jazz. And I collected all his CDs. Really? He's just incredible.
Sammy did one of his, when he wasn't doing the Cuckoo Cachoo stuff, one of his great albums was with Lorenzo Almeida.
Yes.
It was just beautiful.
Yeah, beautiful.
And Sammy, late in his career, would bring, and he brought them to Circle Star, he brought Basie with Ella, and Ella opened for him, and he brought Sarah Vaughan. Mm-hmm. So it was really nice.
Yeah, it's good to hear those people.
Talk about how, we talked about at the opening of the show, Tapestry and Talent. You do a lot of festivals.
I've been doing a lot of festivals. I enjoy them. I really enjoy them. But I think the venues that I enjoy the most are the little jazz clubs.
Yeah.
Because the people are, they're right in front of you. They really pay attention. Yeah. You have a great rapport with them. You know, right away you can feel the vibe from them. And I really, really enjoy that. Even though the money's not that great.
Yeah.
But it's great to play for sport.
I've told this story before. I remember. Years ago, my daughter went to see Britney Spears, and I said, how are your seats? And she said, it was right next to the screen. And I went, you know, I used to see Sinatra. He looked at me, and I look at him. And that's what's so special about those little clubs.
Exactly. Yeah. So I enjoy that more, but, you know, the festivals are a lot of fun, and that's what's going on all during the summer, because the outdoor things, you know, they have... Some of them, they have like five or six bands the whole day, or they run for a weekend, you know. So I'm doing the John Coltrane Festival September 2nd. Sheila and I, Sheila will be in the band with me. And,
where's that?
It's in Greensboro, North Carolina. Yeah.
Did you know Jim Marshall, the photographer?
Jim Marshall.
He did the Coltrane stuff. I think he did the last. He did a tremendous amount of.
Yeah, I know of him, but I never met him.
Good guy. Yeah. Who are you signed with now for? So you're still the same.
This last CD, I did it on my own.
Back to the Bay. Yeah. But that's changed. I mean, you've seen that whole thing change in your lifetime.
It's completely changed. It's a whole different ballgame now. You know, the record companies.
Who did you start? I started out
with Columbia.
Right.
You know,
right.
Clive Davis signed us to Columbia. But it's a whole different ballgame. You know, most everybody has their own studios in their homes.
Yeah.
So we recorded a lot of stuff at home, and it's a different kind of thing. You go in, you work in one studio, you can work somewhere else in another studio and have different people. So it's not like before where the record company signed you.
Where they actually promote you.
Yeah, they promote, they send you, they even send you on tours.
Yeah.
All of that stuff is gone. Yeah, no more.
And they sadly have gone the way of the record stores. I don't know if there are any left.
Yeah, I know.
I think Virgin may have one left somewhere.
Yeah, they're all disappearing. Yeah. Well, it's
your product. You sell a lot online?
I sell online on Amazon.
Amazon, okay.
And my own website, PeteEscovedo.com. Okay. And we sell them at venues. Okay. Unfortunately, for the venue today,
you forgot.
Well, no, I had some, but we sold them all the last gig I had. Yeah. They went like crazy, so
they can order.
I don't have anything left. Yeah.
We referenced Tony Bennett a while ago, and you have something else. Well, you're much younger than he is, but you have something else in common with him. That you're quite an artist.
Yes. Yes.
What's the word, vehicle?
I had art critic look at my work, and she called it muralistic. Okay. So my paintings are muralistic.
So are they oil?
Yeah, oils, acrylics. Okay. I tried everything. I just do a lot of different stuff. And, you know, when I started out painting, it was just for my own enjoyment. Mm-hmm. Put my paintings in my house. Everything's cool, you know. But, you know, people started to buy them. So now I'm in, you know, showing my work in galleries. I'm in a gallery in Oakland right now. And then also I have one piece in Black Hawk at the museum there. That's in Black Hawk. And so, yeah, I've been busy with the painting. Yeah.
Now, on the website, you can, do you have the artwork on
there
as well?
Yeah, I have the artwork on my website. People can buy the book.
You can buy the artwork. You can buy the CD.
Everything.
Get his home address. He'll come to the house. He'll say hello.
And my wife will invite
you. That's right.
To dinner. Yeah, cool.
Talk to me a little. You're 80, right?
83.
Well, I hope I look that good. I don't care. 83, 103. You still have a bucket list. What do you got left that you'd love to do?
Well, I still want to go to Cuba and play. I haven't played in Cuba.
Have you never been to Cuba?
I've never been to Cuba. Each year I try to get on the jazz festival there, which is held in December, I think. And I haven't made it yet, but I don't know. We've been talking with people. Sometimes it's kind of just an exchange thing, you know. So we're trying to work that out. And so two places, that's Cuba and Brazil. I've never been. But
really?
Yeah, but I've been everywhere else. You know.
Did you ever meet Joe Beam and Gilberto and those guys?
I've never met Joe Beam, but I did meet Yvonne Linz. And I love him. He's a great, great musician, a really good player. Yeah, I love his work.
I'm trying to think of the film. I've gone blank. Where Bossa Nova really started. Black Orpheus,
yes.
The film. And a buddy of mine, I was there, and he said, you know, you sat there and all of a sudden it was an epiphany.
Yeah.
It was a new world.
Yeah, it is. I love Brazilian music. Yeah. I've always tried to do a Brazilian sort of song in all my performances and CDs. So I'll be doing a couple of them, yeah.
How would you describe, if somebody said, you know, I've never seen you, don't know anything about you, what kind of music you play?
Well, what I do is, you know, it's kind of hard to explain because my upbringing, of course, I love jazz, but then I love the Latin instruments, and knowing Tito Puente and all the great guys that play, I try to combine both. And when I combine both, all of a sudden now with the new CD, I thought I would do something different because I went back and listened to a lot of the old R&B songs. Those standard R&B songs that were so great. I said, well, what if I take some of these songs and put the Latin jazz thing on it? I wonder what that would sound like. So we did it, and actually it came out really good. So that's what basically why the name of the CD is Back to the Bay, Back to Oakland, you know.
Did you write everything on here?
I didn't write everything. Most of the songs have been recorded, like, you know, Stevie Wonder's song, Earth, Wind, Fire song, like that, yeah. And so that's the kind of stuff we did, yeah.
Tonight we'll pay a little tribute to Aretha.
She was so great. Yeah. I was very fortunate. She had called us one year, it was her birthday, and I don't remember how old she was then, but we went to Detroit and played for her birthday party.
Really?
It was so much fun, and she's so nice, you know. I was thrilled. Even
it was a special lady.
Yeah, because, you know, whoever thought that she would invite us to go and play at her birthday.
Well, and what's particularly unique and really special about her life is that she she came full circle. I mean, she was such a civil rights.
That's right.
Profound effect on the civil rights movement. Sang at Dr. King's funeral.
Yes,
40 years later, sang at Obama's inauguration.
Yeah, that was special.
That was neat.
She was a special lady.
Yeah.
We're going to miss her.
The new album is called Back to the Bay.
Mm-hmm.
The book is called, your hair was a little wavier for that picture.
I looked like this.
This is a great shot. Well, My Life in the Key of E.
There's a picture in there when I was really young. Yeah. And there's one on the CD there where I was really, I look like Paul Anka.
You know you do a little bit. You do a little bit. Well, like Paul Anka, you've had your way for a long time.
Yeah.
A joy to see you, my friend.
Great to see you.
Let's not make it another 40 years. But you have always been accessible, and for young people to come up and say hello, and it you really embody what jazz is about.
Yeah. I have a great fan base. I mean, I think I've been true to the music and what I've played over the years and what I've been doing. And I think a lot of people really appreciate that, and they really come to hear the music, and you know, I appreciate every moment, every time I play. It's just a new experience.
God bless you, partner.
Yeah, God bless you. Thank
you. Good to see you, my friend. Right. That does it for us as we wrap up 2018 and our tribute to Ella Fitzgerald, a great lady. Next year, we're going to pay tribute to Chet Baker,
which will be very cool.
So we'll be on KCAT throughout the year, and I hope you catch these interviews many times, and we sure appreciate you viewing them. And a big thanks to the Pruneyard Cinemas for sponsoring us again. So until next June, when we once again keep jazz alive and pull it out of the closet, I'm Jacoby. I'll see you soon.